Hello dear friends, welcome to the lecture of real analysis. In this lecture we will start the chapter of the Riemann integral, and in this lecture we will study what is a set of measure zero examples and some problems on this sets of measure zero. Further, in the chapter of Riemann integral we will see upper division, upper sum and lower sum, or a subdivision. Upper integral and lower integral we will define, and then we will define Riemann integral. Then we shall study some properties of Riemann integral. Further, we will study the fundamental theorem of calculus in this chapter. But today we will see what is sets of measure zero. I have written a definition here. First, we shall see if J is an interval of real numbers, we denote the length of J by mod of J. So if J is an interval, may be open or closed. So if I consider the interval J, suppose if J is the interval say 3, 7, open interval, then length of J is denoted by this absolute value mod of J, and that is mod of J will be the length of the interval which can be obtained by subtracting b minus a, or 7 minus 3, that is 4. So 4 is the length of the interval 3, 7. Similarly, the lengths of interval can be obtained, any interval can be obtained by subtracting the greater number, subtracting the smaller number from the greater number, and length is to be positive. Now we define what is the set of measure 0. The subset E of R1 is said to be of measure 0 if for each epsilon greater than 0 there exist a finite or countable number of open intervals such I1, I2 and so on, such that E is contained in union of In, and summation of In mod In over N is less than epsilon. So what is the meaning of these two conditions? E is said to be measure 0 if there exist a countable number of open intervals which cover E. That means E is contained in union of all such intervals In, and the second condition is length of sum of lengths sigma n of In mod In, means mod of I1 plus mod of I2 plus mod of I3 and so on. So sum of these length of each interval I1, I2, In must be less than epsilon. That means it must be very small. So the intervals must be of very, very small length, and not only the each interval is a very small length, but their sum is small. Sum of lengths of each interval is less than epsilon. So these are the two conditions for set of measure 0. Then we say E is of measure 0, or in other words, E is of measure 0 if given epsilon greater than 0. So these conditions are stated in words. Given epsilon greater than 0, E can be covered by a union of open intervals. So this is the meaning. The meaning of this condition is E is covered, E is contained, or E is subset of union of these intervals In, that means I1, I2, etc. So or in other words, E is subset of union In, means I1 union I2 union I3 may be finite or infinite, but it must be countable. That is the condition. It is finite or countable. And second condition is, so this is the first condition, and second is sigma In, sigma of mod of In means mod I1 plus mod I2, summation is over N, plus mod of I3 and plus so on. So sum of these lengths is less than epsilon. That means, that is written, E is covered by these union of open intervals. The intervals are open, and whose lengths, these are the lengths. This is length of I1, we have written here. This is length of I1, length of I2, length of I3, and thus these lengths add up to be less than epsilon. So this is the meaning of set of measure 0. Now one simple example we shall consider for set of measure 0. Every set consisting of one point, or every one point set, or singleton set, that means a singleton set is of major 0. Now, how to prove this? We will consider let E is equal to x, consists only one point, that is x. E may, in particular, E may be taken as 5, etc., where x belongs to R or R1, real number. Then what we have to show, we have to find open interval which cover E, that means this point x, and whose sum of lengths is less than epsilon. But this is a single point, and therefore we can consider neighborhood of this x. Now let I is equal to, or we can consider only single interval is sufficient for this, and that interval will contain x. So around x we have to consider a neighborhood, and that we will consider of x minus epsilon by 2, x plus epsilon by 2. So why we have considered like this? Because the length of this interval must be less than epsilon. Now this certainly contains x, or if you see the figure, this is R, and E is a subset of R which contains only one point x. So around this we have to consider the neighborhood of x, and that neighborhood of x we have taken x minus epsilon by 3 and x plus epsilon by 3. Now what is the this certainly contains x. X is the middle point of this interval. So then E is contained in I1. One interval is sufficient for this. There may be finite I1 only, or I1, I2, I3, etc., or infinite but countable. This countable number, we can count this I1, I2, etc. And here for single term set X, there is one interval is sufficient, that is I1, which is we have taken X minus epsilon by 3, X plus epsilon by 3. Not necessarily we should take minus epsilon by 3. The length here, or the radius of this interval is epsilon by 3. Why we have taken epsilon by 3? Because, and what is the length of this interval? That is, see, the length of this interval is x plus epsilon by 3 minus x minus epsilon by 3, which is epsilon by 3 plus epsilon by 3. X cancels, and therefore it is 2 epsilon by 3, and this is less than epsilon. That's why we have taken epsilon by 3. If you take epsilon, x minus epsilon, x plus epsilon, then the length will be 2 epsilon, which is greater than epsilon, and therefore we have taken it is x minus epsilon by 3, x plus epsilon by 3. Or you may take I1 is equal to x minus epsilon by 4, x plus epsilon by 4. Then what will be the length? That the length will be epsilon by 2. See, epsilon by 4 plus epsilon by 4, that is 2 epsilon by 4, means the length will be epsilon by 2, which is again less than epsilon. The interval may be taken as this one or this one, etc. Number of ways of expressing I1. Only these are all neighborhood of x, and therefore one interval is sufficient to cover this E. E is covered by this I1, or E is contained by contained in this I1, and the length of the interval is less than epsilon, and that means every one point set is of major 0. So this is the meaning of set of major 0. The condition is that set is covered by a union of open intervals, this condition, and whose lengths, sum of lengths, is less than epsilon. Now we shall state a theorem about this sets of major 0, that we write as theorem 1. If each sets subsets of R1 each sets or you can say subsets or each subset E1, E2 and so on of R1 is of major zero. Then their union of En, union is over n, that is E1 union E2, the meaning of this is E1 union E2 union E3 and so on is of major zero, then this is also of major zero. So this is our first theorem on sets of major zero. Each subset E1, E2, so on of R1 is of major zero. Then union of En is also of major zero. Now the proof for this, we take any epsilon greater than zero, or you can fix epsilon greater than zero. Take any epsilon greater than zero. Now given that each En for all n belongs to I is of major zero. So given that En belongs to I, positive number, integer, positive integer 1, 2, etc. For n belongs to I is of major zero, therefore En can be covered by a finite, by definition of a set of major zero, En can be covered by a finite or countable number of open intervals. Whose lengths add? This is what we are writing the definition. Whose lengths add up to b less than epsilon, and less than epsilon. But here we take epsilon as epsilon divided by 2 power n purposefully. Because epsilon is arbitrary, the interval as x minus epsilon by 3, x plus epsilon by 3, that is the interval we have taken, and its length is now we have obtained as 2 epsilon by 3. So therefore here what we have considered, the length is less than epsilon, and in place of epsilon we can write epsilon by 2 power n, because it is not arbitrary, it can be taken. In place of epsilon we can take epsilon by 2, epsilon by 3, epsilon by 10, etc. So that is also a number, given number. And so thus for En is of major zero, it can be covered by a finite or countable number of open intervals whose lengths add up to be less than epsilon by 2 power n. So what is the meaning of this? Therefore, the union En will be covered by all such open intervals. But En is covered by open intervals. If you consider n as 1, this happens for each n, for n belongs to I. So En can be covered by a finite or countable number of open intervals. So E1 will be covered by the open intervals whose lengths add up to epsilon divided by 2 power 1. E2 will be covered by open intervals, finite or countable number of open intervals whose length add up to be less than epsilon by 2 square, and so on. En, for En, we have En is covered by open intervals, finite open intervals or countable number of open intervals whose lengths add up to epsilon by 2 power n. So that is the meaning of this statement. Therefore, for each n belongs to I, so we can add the condition as for n belongs to I, En can be covered by a finite or countable number of open intervals. Then union of En, so each En is covered by open intervals, so therefore their union is also covered by open intervals. Then union of En is covered by countable number of open intervals. Whose lengths add up to less than. Now see, first even the lengths add up to less than epsilon by 2 power 1. So that is less than epsilon by 2, E1. And E2 is covered by the open intervals. We have not mentioned which open intervals, but there, by definition, there exist open intervals which cover E2. But there some of the open intervals which cover E2, the sum of lengths will be less than epsilon by 2 square. And we are considering all these, union of this. So E1 union, E2 union, E3. And the sum of the intervals will be like this. Sum of their lengths will be like this. Epsilon by 2 power 1, that is epsilon by 2, epsilon by 2 square, and epsilon by 2 cube, etc. Or we can write plus so on. In general, En will be covered by epsilon by 2 power n, but this may be infinite. So E1, E2, etc. So this E1, E2, etc., that is countably infinite, maybe. And therefore, finite or infinite, maybe. And therefore, we write up to infinity. And thus, this can be further simplified as. Now, we can take epsilon common, 1/2, then the series remains, 1/2 plus 1 by 2 square, plus so on, 1 by 2 power n, plus so on. And we write common epsilon here. And this can be written as, this is a geometric series, the common ratio is 1 by 2 and the first term is also 1 by 2. And therefore, this is equal to the sum of this, sum of first n terms, the formula is 1/2, that is a first term into bracket 1 minus r power n, r is common ratio, and that is 1/2 power n divided by 1 minus 1/2. So this is the formula for sum of the n terms, first n terms, that means 1/2 plus 1 by 2 square plus up to 1 by 2 power n. This is exactly equal to this, but it is infinite. So therefore, we can write limit this as limit n tends to infinity, and epsilon is multiple of this into epsilon. So the formula we have used is using a plus ar plus so on up to ar power n or n minus 1. Here now these are first n terms, and this is equal to a in bracket 1 minus r power n divided by 1 minus r. So this is the formula that we have used here. And now you see what is the limit of this. This is equal to we know the limit of this term, n is only here. If this limit of a power n or r power n, if r is less than 1, this limit is 0, because actually it will be 1 upon 2 power n. As limit n tends to infinity, this term becomes infinite, and 1 over infinity is tending to 0. So therefore this term tends to 0 and 1 minus 0 will be 1. This is half and this is also half. So that this limit, entire limit becomes 1 only, 1 into epsilon, and that is epsilon. So what we have written here, the lengths add up to less than epsilon. So this is the series, but now this is exactly equal to this and so on, but the relation is lengths add up to less than epsilon. And this shows that the union of En is covered by countable number of open intervals whose lengths add up to less than epsilon, and therefore union of En is of measure 0. So this proves that union of En is also of measure 0. So hence, and this completes the proof of the theorem. So thus we have proved that if E1, E2 and so on are of measure 0, then their union is also of measure 0. So our union of arbitrary union of measurable sets, sets of measure 0 is also of measure 0. That is the meaning of the theorem. Now we can consider an example or corollary to this. A countable set is of measure 0. A countable subset of R1. Is of measure 0. Now we shall prove this result. Let A be a countable subset of R1. And we know a countable subset can be written like this. Therefore, A can be written as, or A can be expressed as, A is equal to, we can count the elements and the scheme can be written as x1, x2, x3 and so on, xn may be finite or infinite, or this can also be written as union of A is equal to union of these sets, singleton sets, x1 union x2 union x3 etc. union and so on, or that we can write union of xn over n, union of xn, n can take value 1 to infinity or may be finite. So this is a countable set, and now we know this xn, each xn is of measure 0. Every single turn set or every one point set is of measure 0, that we have seen earlier after definition of a set of measure 0, and therefore each xn is of measure 0, therefore their union is also of measure 0 by this theorem. Union of En is of measure 0, in place of En here it is xn, and that is E1 is x1, E2 is x2 etc. Since each xn, n belongs to I, is of measure 0, union of xn union is over n is also of measure 0. This follows by theorem 1. And hence a countable set, countable subset of R1 is of measure 0. Therefore, or hence, a countable subset of R1 is of measure 0. So that gives examples, number of examples. Countable sets are all of measure 0. And what are the countable sets? We know that from this, the set of integers is countable, the set of natural numbers is countable, etc. The set of integers, all integers, the set of rational numbers, etc., are countable, and therefore of measure 0, are of measure 0. So these are infinite sets, but these are of measure 0 because they can be covered by countable open intervals. They can be covered by countable open intervals like this, and which is the whose lengths add up to less than epsilon, or countable open these countable sets which are each of measure 0. So for example, if I consider the set of integers I, that is so positive integers, if you consider, then it will be 1, 2, 3, etc. Then this is union of these intervals, and each singleton set is of measure 0, therefore their union is also of measure 0, or that is actually equal to union of n. N takes value 1 to infinity, and therefore it is of measure 0. So same thing happens for rational numbers, because the set of rational number is also countable. So this this is the definition of set of measure 0, and we have seen examples of set of measure 0. Now we will solve few problems on sets of measure 0. But before solving these problems, we will see one more definition which is important. I have written the definition here. A statement is said to hold at almost every point. Hold at almost every point of the interval, open or closed interval a comma b. Or it may be said, or almost everywhere in the closed interval a comma b, if the set of points of the closed interval a comma b at which the statement does not hold is of measure 0. That means the statement holds almost everywhere except there is few exception. It may not hold at few or few countable number of points. Then we can say the statement holds almost everywhere. There is some exception, but the exceptional points must be countable. For example, we say a function f. Example of this, we will consider a function f of x. Let f of x is equal to, say, x plus 1 divided by x minus 1 into x minus 3. Now this function, consider the interval the AB is. Suppose the interval AB is, say, I shall take the interval as 0 to 5. Now this function is continuous in this interval except the points x is equal to 1 and x is equal to 3, and that means, so the function fx is continuous except at point x is equal to 1 and x is equal to 3, where if you take x is equal to 1, then the denominator becomes 0, the function is not defined, and x is 3, the function is also not defined, and therefore the function is continuous everywhere except x is equal to 1 and x is equal to 3. And but we can say the function is continuous at almost everywhere in this interval, because the set of points, then fx is continuous. Then fx is continuous at almost every point. Almost every point in 0 comma 5, closed interval 0 comma 5, because since the set of points, where the function is not continuous, where fx is not continuous, is, what is the set that we may denote the set as A, and at which point it is not continuous, 1 and 3. Is of measure is this and it is, and A is of measure 0. We have seen this countable set. This is a countable set, two elements are there, and every countable set is of measure 0 and A is of measure 0. So therefore, a property where the property does not hold, that set of points is must be of measure 0, then we can say the property holds or the statement holds at almost every point of the closed interval a comma b. So that is the meaning of this definition. Statement is valid or hold at almost every point of the interval a comma b if the set of points where it does not hold is of measure 0. There is only a few exception or countable number of points at which the property may not hold. Then we say the property holds at almost every point of the closed interval. So that is the meaning of this statement. Why we have written this definition? Because this we are going to use for the existence of Riemann integral. The function is continuous at almost every point in the closed interval, then it is Riemann integrable on the closed interval. So that we will further state in the existence theorem of Riemann integral. So thus, up till now what we have defined is set, what is meaning of set of measure 0, and that means it must be covered in countable number of open intervals and whose lengths add up to less than epsilon. And almost everywhere point the property holds, if the points at which it does not holds must be the set of measure 0. Now here are few problems I have written, we will solve it. What is the first is, prove that a non-empty open interval, however small it may be, is never of measure 0. So that means an interval that we will consider here AB. So the interval AB we will consider. Solution for first problem. Let E is the open interval AB. A comma B belongs to R1 and A is less than B. So this is the set. Now what is the length of the interval E? Length of E is mod E, and that is B minus A. This is the length of E. Now we know this is open interval, and open interval E can be covered by open intervals I1, I2. This is countable or can be covered by countable open intervals. This is a theorem on open set. An open interval of R1 can be covered by countable open intervals I1, I2, etc. That is disjoint. Again, these countable open intervals are disjoint, which are disjoint, or countable open intervals I1, I2, etc., which are disjoint, or disjoint open intervals can be covered by disjoint countable open intervals. That is, E is covered by union IN. This is true. This holds. This property holds. But what is the sum of length of IN? So the sum of length of IN will be again the length of E, that is equal to B minus A. So that means if you see, this is AB open interval, then that open interval can be covered by countable number of disjoint open intervals like this, I1, I2, etc. And this must cover the whole set, the whole interval A to B. And what will be the sum of lengths of these? Will be again equal to the length of the interval that is a comma b, open interval a comma b, which is b minus a. And thus if you take epsilon as, if we take epsilon is equal to b minus a, then what is this sigma n of mod I n? This is b minus a, and is not less than epsilon. This is not less than epsilon. Or if you take epsilon is less than b minus a, if you take b minus a or less than b minus a, the length add up to b minus a, and if you take epsilon less than b minus a, then the sum of lengths will not be less than epsilon, and that means the second condition fails for set of measure 0, and therefore this open interval, however small it may be, is not of measure 0. Therefore e is not of measure 0. Hence e is not of measure 0. However small it may be, we have written. So for example, if I write this interval 0 comma 1 is not of measure 0, or instead this can also be written as 0 comma half, etc. However small or large the interval may be, is not of measure 0, etc. or not of measure 0. If I consider like this 0 comma 1, then e is of measure 0. This is countable. This is countable. There are only two elements, 0 and 1. But this is uncountable. It is open interval. All real numbers between 0 and 1. And here there are only two numbers, 0 and 1. So that is the difference in writing. This is open interval and this is discrete set, which contains only two elements, is of measure 0. So that is the meaning here. A non-empty open interval, however small it may be, is never of measure 0. This is the first problem we have solved. Now the solution for the second problem. The second problem is A is not of measure 0. B subset of A, and B is of measure 0. Then A minus B is of measure 0. So that we have to approve. A minus B is not of measure 0. B is of measure 0. Here it should be corrected. A minus B is not of measure 0. A minus B is not of measure 0. Now this result we shall prove by taking a contradictory proof or indirect proof. Suppose if possible A minus B is of measure 0. Now given B is subset of A and B is of measure 0, we can draw the figure. Then this is A, the universal set, we may suppose this as A, and B is subset of A, means this will be B. So what is A? A will be this rest part will be B, A minus B. So this set is A minus B. This is A minus B and this is B. So A will be expressed as, then we can write A is equal to A minus B, or B union A minus B. This is B and outer region is A minus B. So union of these two is the whole set A. So this we can write because B is subset of A. Now what is given? See, B is of measure 0. Now A is the union of two sets of measure 0. B is of measure 0, A minus B, we assume is of measure 0. Then A is union of two sets of measure 0, sets B and A minus B, each of which are of measure 0. That means A is union of two sets which are of measure 0, and by the theorem 1, so A must be of measure 0. So this, then A is of measure 0. By theorem 1. But you see, this is a contradiction. What is given? A is not of measure 0. So what? This is a contradiction. And why this contradiction has arrived? Because our supposition is wrong. And that means A minus B is of measure 0 is wrong, means A minus B must not be of measure 0. Hence, A minus B is not of measure 0, or this proves. That means from a set which is not of measure 0, we subtract a set of measure 0, then also we shall get a set of which is not of measure 0. So this completes the solution of the second problem. Third problem, you should try using the second problem. What is to be proved? Set of irrational number is not of measure 0. So we will take R, the set of real numbers. Real numbers, and Q, rational numbers, and Q dash you may take set of irrational numbers. What is relation for this? Now what is R? R is not of measure 0. Set of real number is not of measure 0. An interval of real numbers is also not of measure 0. R is not of measure 0. In place of A, we take R. R is not of measure 0. And what about Q? Q, the set of rational number is countable and therefore is of measure 0. Is of measure 0. And what about Q dash? That we have to determine. And what is Q dash? Q dash is the complement of Q in R. That means we have Q dash is equal to R minus Q. And that is also not of measure 0. By this, see, R is in place of A, there is R. In place of B, it is Q. And therefore, R is not of measure 0, Q is of measure 0, therefore R minus Q, which is irrational numbers. Rational and irrational are disjoint, they together form R, and therefore Q dash is R minus Q is not of measure 0. So like this, you should solve the third problem. So this is the hint for the third problem. The second is to be used in solving the third problem. So thus we have studied set of measure 0, some examples and some problems on set of measure 0. Remaining part we will continue in our next lecture. Thank you for watching.